Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah and welcome to Living Muslim. With the growth of the internet and social media becoming so easily accessible, everything has to be on the internet now, and everything is on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube. You can't escape it. And with this has come the growth of celebrities, superstars, football stars, soccer stars, whatever the case is, and the masses of people are following, and it's happening everywhere. Now, with the growth of this, also the growth of da'wah has also taken on the internet, and it's also taken on the growth of this, you know, this whole social media. So joining me today in the studio to speak about celebritism, I guess, if you like, in da'wah and in deen, is joining me in the studio is Sheikh Sajid Umar, who is currently based in Riyadh, and that's all that I can say for now, he says to me. So Sheikh, thank you very much for joining us. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It's a pleasure. Barakallahu feekum.
Wallahi, thank you so much for being here. It's an absolute pleasure and it's an honor to have you here with us.
Barakallahu feekum. It's an honor living Muslim with Hoblos. It's an honor to be with you.
May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you. Sheikh, with the advent of social media, the internet, as we've mentioned, this has come on to our deen. And alhamdulillah, da'wah has used the internet for many good things, but it's also grabbed a lot of ill things along with it. But what does sort of tend to happen, and I guess this is my question to be a bit more specific to you, is many of us, we do tend to have a liking, you know, whether towards a particular channel or a particular da'i or a sheikh or so, and then we're somewhat treating this person like a celebrity. Now, is this wrong? And if so, how should I be dealing with someone that I love or someone that I admire and keeping it halal, I guess, in that sense?
There's benefit having the da'wah accessible, right? As you said, Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and all the other social platforms. But yes, if not controlled, then shaitan is always out there to cause retrogression. So if he's not going to stop something, you know, becoming exacerbated and spreading in a way, then he's going to try and pollute the rewards that can come about as a result of it, pollute the way people are accessible to it, you know, pollute the reasons why perhaps they attach to it, right? And that's when it carries negative baggage. So your question is it a bad thing to see the celebrity fan culture in the da'wah? Well, or fan culture in the da'wah? Well, the reality is that whenever we learn from anybody, it's to learn from the inheritance of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the reality of the inheritance of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that it doesn't just fix minds, but it converts hearts. Allah. It changes hearts, right? So, and the reality with regards to this inheritance is that the one who attaches himself or herself to it is engaged in an act of worship. Now, when we understand these realities, then we understand that there are certain conditions, there are certain elements that have to come into play, irrespective of circumstance, such as sincerity. Because no one engages an act of worship for anyone else other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the purpose has to be Allah. The means by which we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is through seeking knowledge. When these elements come into play, then we find, you know, negativity in our citation that there's a celebrity fan culture here, because that shouldn't be the case. You know, whenever we study with a sheikh or learn from a da'i or take inspiration, it should be for the sake of Allah. And the inspiration that we've taken or the knowledge that we've learned has to have physical or a physical presence in our life, that we took what we learned and put it into practice. So if there's, you know, if we're going to talk about, you know, celebrity or fan, it has to be that I'm a fan in terms of worshipping Allah. I'm a fan of the inheritance of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam because that helps me worship Allah. There has to be a detachment between the love that we have for the speaker, for the sheikh, for the da'i, and the love that we have for the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that we come to an understanding and say, look, we love this person because he's a carrier of the things taught to us by the one who we truly love. So, and that is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
This is nice. Like, I like this. So can someone measure himself? As in, look, you know, my love to this speaker or my love to this da'i, can I measure this by saying, well, okay, how much of what this person speaks of am I actually implementing?
That's the measure.
Or not?
That's the measure.
Nice.
That's the measure.
Tab Sheikh, also along with, you know, also along with the whole social media and all the other stuff, is we're also starting to see a new thing springing up. Well, it's not really new, but it's sort of to, you know, it's starting to pick up pace, I guess, is conferences. And you find conferences are happening everywhere, and they're happening not just in the English-speaking world. They're actually quite big all over the world. And you yourself are no stranger to this, mashallah. You know, I've seen your schedule every now and then. You're sort of, you're all over the place visiting these conferences. How do we draw the line? I mean, our conference is good. I believe that they are. But how can we make the most of conferences? Because, let me be a bit more specific. What I find is happening is that our deen is becoming events. Right? So now I'll go to a Thursday night talk. I'll go to a conference. We're there. Okay? But, you know, what happens after that? So, you know, if you can maybe shed some light on you know, on your personal experiences with conferences and maybe some advice.
Yeah, I mean, without opening too many cans of worms, obviously. And I think it's a follow-up from what you're discussing about, you know, the internet and presence on the internet. Now we have conferences that, that bring about a greater presence on the ground. So you have online and you have on-site. No doubt there's goodness in it. There's blessings in it. People become inspired there. It provides a chance for somebody to, or, you know, a conference actually provokes the thought of people if it's run the right way. But I think what needs to happen is that which we said earlier, that it's the worship of Allah. And the worship of Allah has to have sincerity. If I'm going to run a conference, I got to be clear that my purpose is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I can't be running it for the sake of running it. And that's the case. We always have to ask ourselves, as we find in the Quran, فَأَيْنَ تَذْهَبُونَ? Where are we going with this? You know, the yardstick, like you said, how do I know whether I'm you know, I attend a conference, I attend a lecture, I watch a YouTube talk, how do I know if it's, you know, am I doing it because I love the speaker, or am I doing it for the sake of Allah? And the yardstick is, how much do you implement from that which you learn? How much do you remember from that which you learn? How much have you grown from that which you've learned? You know, is it about the selfie? Is it about the picture? Is it about me being at the event, the hype of the event, the venue of the event, the speakers that attended the event? Or is it about truly me running to the inheritance of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Because when I heard there was an event, I knew that the messages of my beloved is going to be presented at this event, and that's why I went. But since you've asked the question, and just to call a spade, and not a big spoon, that there is this element that the internet has created, that conferences have created. We're not saying that that was intended. No, no da'i is going out there, you know, to create fame. No conference is happening because the organization wants to create fame. But we also have to be sensitive to certain realities that are a sign of the times that come about. And when we're sensitive to these realities, then we can come up with the system that allows our da'wah to be robust in a way that people are studying with us and we are teaching in a way that is most conducive to Islam. That we are calling to Islam always. The conference is calling to Islam. The YouTube videos are calling to Islam. The khutbahs are calling to Islam. And it's not a case that shaytan has put us in where subconsciously we're calling to ourselves. So, you know, these are a few yardsticks that I mentioned given the multifaceted question that you've shared. But it is a long discussion, Akhil Karim.
Tab Sheikh, one last thing that I want to ask you before we sort of do wrap it up is, does it suffice? Let me give you an example. If I'm getting the majority of my deen from the internet through whether it's Facebook, you know, YouTube videos or going to conferences, is this enough for me to say that, look, I've learned my deen through these avenues? Is it enough to just attend these things, or should my deen incorporate more than this?
I mean, look, in terms of learning, it's never enough. We know that seeking knowledge happens from the beginning of our life till the end of our life.
Does there have to be a connection?
So there has to be a connection.
Yani, do I have to be connected, not so much to a masjid as in the structure or the actual building, but does there have to be a connection?
There has to be a connection between the knowledge that you learn and what you practice, right? Because you can't practice before you have knowledge. And when you have knowledge, it mandates amal. Like Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, in his sahih, he has a whole chapter, Babu al-ilmi qabla al-qawli wal-amal, right? The chapter of knowledge before speech and action.
Right.
So these are the twins of faith. They are aligned. Al-ilm, knowledge, and al-amal, action. And knowledge comes before action. Even if you look at the makeup of the words, you have in ilm, lam comes before meme. And in amal, the meme comes before the lam. And if you look at the alphabet, the Arabic alphabet, you find lam coming before the meem. So ilm is going to come before action. You know, if we try and have a linguistic nuance to it or an abstract discussion of it. And even if you look at the messaging in the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the topic that we're discussing is about the internet age and the celebrity fan culture. No doubt there has to be a connection. Firstly, you must learn on the internet. You must attend the conferences, right? You must learn from as many knowledgeable people as possible. And you must put what you learn into practice. But what you should never do, and this can help us avoid the celebrity fan culture, is attach yourself only to one speaker or one particular conference. Why? Because no one thing can give you all of the inheritance of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There's certain du'at, certain conferences that can take you from level zero to level one. After that, you are in need of other mashayikh, other teachers, other conferences, other seminaries, other programs to take you from level one to level two, and then level two to level three. If you always stuck to one, and you're stuck on a particular level, a time has to come when you have your quote-unquote thinking day, when you ask yourself, look, where am I in my relationship to Allah? And you ask yourself, that, okay, how come I'm not progressing? How come I'm always stuck on this level? A lot of the times people tell me that, you know, Sheikh, we need an iman boost. Or, you know, we really love if Sheikh so-and-so comes because we're going to get the iman boost. And I tell them that, you know, attaching your iman and its growth to a particular person is not sustainable. It's not sustainable. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left us. And when he left us, he said, تَرَكْتُ فِيكُمْ مَا إِن تَمَسَّكْتُمْ بِهِ لَن تَضِلُّ بَعْدِ أَبَدًا كِتَابُ اللَّهِ وَسُنَّتِي. That I leave with you two things. If you hold steadfast upon them both, you'll never go astray. That's the Quran and the Sunnah. The Quran and the Sunnah, that is with us forever. That, you know, you gaining inspiration from that is sustainable. Because the da'i will come and leave. And then what's going to happen the next day? Yeah, right. You need, even a vehicle needs to have that system which charges the battery. Without it, you're going to keep on going through batteries. It's not sustainable for a person to keep visiting your vicinity or locality to give you that iman boost. Firstly, financially it's expensive. You can feed many poor people, right? Yeah. Secondly, we don't live forever, right? So attaching ourselves to the Quran and the Sunnah is the iman boost. And structuring how we learn and implement what we learn will help us appreciate the great presence of the Quran and Sunnah in our life.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you, Sheikh. Thank you so, so very much for joining us.
Barakallahu feek.
You've brought so much joy and nur. Brothers and sisters, I guess there you have it. There's goods and bads in everything that we do in our life. And for a believer, one needs to always strike the balance. Too much of anything is never ever a good thing. So yes, while we have the internet and we may fall in love with mashayikh and da'is, and this love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts in the hearts, but too much of this and abusing this may end up destroying you. So it is always good for a believer to strike a balance. Can I take my deen from the internet? Well, just as the Sheikh said, yes, you can. But do I take all my deen from the internet? No, this is dangerous. Am I allowed to fall in love with the Sheikh and take some advice from him? Yes, you are. But do I take all my deen from him and from no one else and listen to him? No, well then this is also dangerous. So one needs to always strike the balance. You know, and just as we go to conferences, which are good things, and we go to, and we go to the Facebook and go to the internet, that should not replace our masjid. That should not replace our halakat. It should not replace being on the ground and going. So we need to strike that balance. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from the balanced ones. Sheikh, once again, thank you so very much. And up until next time, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward every single one of you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.